letting it all hang out now on BBC Two. The language is strong and so are the opinions about all sorts of stuff. The scary thing is when you find yourself agreeing with the grumpy old men.
The 35 to 54-year-old age group is the grumpiest of any in Britain today. They're grumpier than their parents, who survived the war and were just grateful to be alive, and grumpier than their children, who don't seem to care very much about anything. Wherever they look, they find something that makes them grumpy.
I'd like to smash up modern technology.
There has been some kind of genetic leap.
Am I computer literate? You've got to be out of your mind.
What is Acrobat Reader?
Do I really have to be on the net? Why must I be on the net?
Shut up! Shut up!
Turn it off before I cut your head off and use it as a bowling ball!
It's not just about modern technology. It's about almost everything. Mobile phones, packaging you can't get into, traffic calming, automated call centres, designer labels, fast food, public transport, traffic and cars.
People love their cars more than they love human beings.
Nobody needs an off-road vehicle unless they're off-road.
Why we put up with it, I simply don't know.
At school, they were told that the white heat of technology would deliver leisure and pleasure. Robots would take care of daily chores. Computers would take the nasty, hard part out of thinking. But it didn't work out that way. Once so simple, life now seems so complicated. They've just got used to one thing, and it's another. Instead of leisure and pleasure, technology has just made everything go faster and faster. Oh, sure, our grumpy old men can keep up with it if they want to. It's just that they're not sure that they want to.
We're assaulted by technology wherever you go. It seems to be never a moment when there's not someone at you with their technology, which is why lots of grumpy men just go off and walk up mountains and are never seen again.
It all started 30 years ago with a video recorder. Watch a program whenever you want to. What a great piece of kit, we all thought. At first, it was so simple. Press record to record and play to play. Then came the remote control, automatic tuning, timers, tracking, 7-day planning, and those 8-digit number codes you had to program in. For our grumpy old men, it was like asking a monkey to paint a Rembrandt. And to add insult to injury, the only people who understand it are the kids.
My wife and I really look forward to their coming home so they can do it for us. But then, of course, they know too much, you know what I mean? So they fix it for their own purposes, you know? So you go to watch a video and you find that they've sort of reprogrammed it so that it'll bottle black currants or something, do you know what I mean? It'll do something other than what you expect it to do.
I'd like to smash up modern technology to preserve my personal traditional craft of sitting around doing bugger all.
We've got stacks of videos that we've never seen because we can't make the video player play them. And DVDs, do me a favour.
There's hardly a workplace in the land that has not been transformed by the computer revolution, which has now put paid to those innocent pleasures afforded by the shorthand typist, the typing pool and the copying department. You can hardly function without being what's known as multi-skilled, and our grumpies are appalled.
I don't know what it means. I suppose, made a conscious decision. I haven't mastered pen and paper yet. You know, I mean, I try and make myself write letters. I like to read books. I like to hold it in me hand lack. You know what I mean? But I can't do no lack, computer lack shit, cos lack. I just don't know how the fuck it goes on. And I don't really believe it has anything to offer me.
I was eventually persuaded to buy a computer. I actually was not having any social life at all. I was being utterly... I was a complete pariah until I bought a computer.
Our grumpy old men hate taking the machine they bought just 18 months ago back into the shop for a spare part, only to have a small crowd of spotty youths gather round to have a good laugh at someone using the technology equivalent of the flintlock musket. They're not quite ready to be patronised by snot-nosed kids.
There has been some kind of genetic leap, and children are born understanding. I think it's because they don't have, they're not frightened of it. You know, they'll just, I bet this is what you do. And then if it doesn't, oh, well, OK, we'll try, and they'll try something else. Whereas, you know, I'm very expecting something to go terrifically wrong.
When the instruction booklet is bigger than the piece of kit and it's unintelligible, that does drive you absolutely crazy, yes.
I have a little man, and a little man comes around to work on the computer. So in fact, I've stepped back technologically to deal with the advanced technology. And the little man's always saying to me, why don't you upgrade? Why don't you get this? Why don't you get that? Why don't you get this peripheral? Why don't you do that? Your computer's ancient. It came out of the pyramid of Cheops. You can't do anything on that. And I just can't be asked. This built-in obsolescence of this technology is phenomenal.
When we were lads, our idea of multi-skilling was reading the paper and shaving at the same time. If your chain came off your bike, it was your dad you turned to for help. Even if his other job was running the country, he always had time to get out the oil can and sort you out. Today, technology has denied Dad even these simple pleasures.
You spill tea on top of your laptop, and if you don't back up, and if your tea's got sugar in it, you know this, don't you? But if your tea's got sugar in it, that's it. You know, if you do it on a laptop, it's smashed. And this is what the guy at the computer...
Well, if your tea's got sugar in it, of course, you're not going to get anything back, are you? Do you take sugar?
The biggest lie that the technology manufacturers sell you is plug and go. It's plug and... Fuck me, I don't know what's going on here. These hours... What are you doing in there from the kitchen? I've just bought this new bit of kit, darling, and I'm just sorting it out, you know, and that goes on for weeks. Yeah. Plug and go. It's a joke.
Of course, once you have the computer, the word processor, the office manager, the calendar, the graphics pack, the accounting software and the printer, you need to get online. It's all so simple. You can go narrowband or broadband, ADSL or cable, pay as you go or all you can eat. You program in your credit card so that someone in Las Vegas can use it to fund their drugs habit. Choose your search engine and then discover that WWW stands for World Wide Wait.
Oh, but you get anything on the internet. Oh, yeah, solution to Northern Ireland peace problem. It's on the internet. You know, cure for cancer, type in cancer, cure, and then there's 3,000 documents about some boy in Milwaukee whose favourite band is The Cure and whose star sign is cancer, and you've read about 10 pages of it before you've worked out it's absolutely no relevance at all to what you want.
Who wants to surf on the net? Who wants to surf on the net? You know, you've got to be brain dead. This is the point at which I recede to being of the analogue, you know, ink and paper generation. I can see the advantage of it, but as a professional working journalist, I hardly ever use it. I'll do it to access Eclipse Library, but I won't read off screen. It drives your brain into an omelette-style mush. You do not want to do that. As for the rest of it, it's wank fodder. Who hits sites? You know, it's sad guys tossing themselves off. It should be called the tosser net, because that is 99% of the traffic.
And speaking of traffic, when our grumpies were at school, they were promised that they would commute into bright and air-conditioned offices in hands-free, bright and shiny vehicles, running smoothly over maintenance-free roads with magic eyes which would prevent them colliding, while a robotic assistant would update them with the latest news. Instead, they sit in small tin boxes with overheated engines, travelling slower than the horse and cart of 100 years ago. Polluting the atmosphere, burning fossil fuels. They're paying 75% tax in petrol, congestion charges, and £40 a day to park. Despite all that, all the expense and frustration, driving is a modern love affair.
Cars. People love their cars more than they love human beings. All that money you turn on the telly and there's adverts. They're marvellous adverts in a way. Creative people have spent hours, years working it out. They've spent a fortune to advertise a bloody car. And they're just cars, they're tin boxes that get you about. And it would be better if we were all on public transport and there were more people in the tin boxes. Rather, one person just loves his car and he prefers his car to any human being.
Amongst friends or family or in a crowd, our grumpy old men can temporarily be distracted from all the many things that rattle their cages. They may even appear to function like everyone else. But when they're on their own, in the car, with nothing else to think about, their minds just wander over life's many bloody irritations.
I think there's a dangerous number of options in a car. In the car that I've got, there's a kind of stick of controls, and I have no idea what it's for at all, absolutely no idea. But the car seems to go all right without it, you know, without my knowing what it means. And there's just too much, too many gadgets.
Motorways first, traffic's at a standstill on the M25 anti-clockwise.
There's something which has been engaged at some stage that interrupts the radio station that you're listening with traffic advice. And I don't know how to switch it off. And so I'm driving along, I've been listening to some record that I really like and singing along with it, possibly if there's nobody else in the car. And suddenly, somebody will come on and tell me what's going on the M25. Now, I know a lot of people drive on the M25, but frankly, I don't give a fuck what's happening on the M25, but I don't want my records to be interrupted by people telling me.
No, what I really hang on the road are bull bars and 4WDs.
They could have used them to invade Iraq, couldn't they? I mean, they're semi-military vehicles, aren't they? All they're saying is, I have lots of money. That's all they're doing. Oh, but we need it to go up hills. No, you don't. You need it to make your penis look bigger.
Nobody needs an off-road vehicle unless they're off-road. Go and live in a field if you want to drive a 4WD. Don't tool up and down the Fulham Road taking little Chloe and Tarquin back and forth to private school in your bloody 4WD with your bull bars, which will kill a child if you're going at 2 miles an hour. That is insane. Go on the Pamplona Bull Run.
With plenty of time to look out of the window in their slow-moving vehicles, our grumpy old men cast their eyes over the environment around them. They sit back and take in the streets in towns and cities, which look as though the nursery class have been given custody over the paint gun and run amok. There are 2 yellow lines down the side of the road telling you not to park. And just in case you can't see them, there are 2 yellow flashes on the pavement, 3 yards apart, telling you again that you can't park. There are 2 red lines where there aren't 2 yellow lines, telling you that you can't park and you can't stop either. So that's don't even think about parking. There are chevrons marking out the area leading up to a bollard, telling you that you might be getting near the bollard. There are wide white lines marking out bus lanes and writing on the bus lane telling you it's a bus lane. And just in case you can't see the lines or the writing, the whole bus lane has been coloured red.
One of the appalling things is not just the amount of street furniture, the observation cameras, the warnings, the notices. It's not so much the sinister evidence of a controlling force which seeks to limit the liberty of individuals, which is uncomfortable and unpleasant enough, but it's the actual visual mess.
Few streets illustrate the point better than Cable Street in the East End of London. Sir Oswald Mosley's volunteers were kept at bay at the famous Battle of Cable Street in the mid-30s. But where the anti-fascists succeeded against Mosley, they would have been no match for the Highways Department. This street is part of our London heritage. Now look at it.
What is it now? Council estates on each side and poles sprouting all the way down Cable Street. There must be about 1,000 tons of steel and concrete with poles and signs indicating which way it's one way this way, which way it's one way that way, which way it's two ways both ways, which side is the cycle track, which way is this track for pedestrians, which way is the track for motorists, signs warning us of a roundabout ahead, signs warning of us of traffic light ahead, signs telling us this, that and the other, endless street lights, far more street lights than are necessary. Vice can't thrive where there are street lights. It was more interesting when everything was dark. And the street furniture, the landscape, is now just a forest of metal poles, concrete lumps, and big blank metal signs all over the place. It's absolutely horrible. The worst of it all, are the pedestrian barriers to try and make pedestrians cross the street here and stop pedestrians from crossing the street somewhere else. There are thousands of tons of metal have gone into all these ghastly barriers which look horrible and don't stop me. Because when I see a pedestrian barrier, I just climb straight over it, even if I wasn't going that way, just to show that I will not be stopped. I'm always having accidents. I'm trying to cross with shopping and I fall off. But even if the pedestrian barrier wants to make me go 2 yards a little way round, I won't. I won't be told what place to choose.
And watching Matthew carrying out his private and slightly deranged one-man revolution is Big Brother. God only knows why he's watching, unless he's just having a laugh at the mess he's created. So our grumpy old men go about their daily business. For much of the time, if you didn't know better, they'd seem just like anyone else. Getting the shopping, going to work, going to the football, going to the cinema. But while grumpy old men may often seem calm and collected on the outside, inside their heads is a constant turmoil. These people can't hear an announcement on the station without mentally correcting the grammar. Can't listen to a politician speaking without noting that he hasn't said anything. Can't see a sign advertising a massive rug sale without wondering out loud who on earth would want to buy a massive rug, and enduring the family all raising their eyes and bleating, "Oh, Dad." Grumpy old men are condemned to a lifetime of silently monitoring the lunacy that is the world around them. But give them a chance. Ask them an apparently innocuous question, and it's like lighting the blue touch paper.
Public transport in Britain is absolutely atrocious. The services are bad, they're crowded, things simply don't come, things are expensive. Why we put up with it, I simply don't know. Why doesn't a political party with only one platform, which is to make public transport better, try putting up, for instance, in London? I would vote for it. I'd vote for a Marxist, I'd vote for a Trotskyite, I'd vote for anybody that promised, with some chance of success, that promised to do something about public transport in London.
How is it, by the way, that when they had an earthquake in San Francisco a few years ago, they have the tube up and running in 2 days after one of the biggest earthquakes the city had seen, and that they had repaired the road at the epicenter within 3 days so that traffic was using it again? We have roadworks, say on the North Circular or on a motorway somewhere in the north, and it will say delays likely for 3 years sometimes. Hangar Lane gyratory system, 4 years to get it right. I mean, what the heck is going on?
And what would they do about it? Well, sometimes desperate situations require desperate solutions.
Pedestrians that don't look out should be killed. And will be, and it'll be an example to the other ones. It's one of the few ways in which the Darwinian selection process is able to continue, is in the squashing of slow pedestrians. Also, that's why I like those buses that you can jump on and off, because it encourages the nimble and the lithe and puts the lame at a competitive disadvantage.
So you're sitting on the tube on your way to work, you've had a row with the wife, you hate the boss, and someone's trying to read your newspaper over your shoulder. And you hear this.
And there's some guy like it's absolutely ridiculous.
Part of me is thinking, well, what is that? What is that tune? I can recognise it. And the other part, this is the more predominant part. Again, there's a lot of stress you're going through. This wants to say, shut that fucking noise up. It's horrible.
Drives you bloody mad when you get on a train and there's some idiot with in their ear the whole way. Or some, there's a new one, it's computer games on trains. Boop, 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 and you shut up, shut up.
It's doing me fucking head in. How can you do that? It's called a personal Walkman. That's what it's called. A personal Walkman, that means it's for you, not for me. I'm 7 feet away. I can hear it. It's really annoying. Turn it off before I cut your head off and use it as a bowling ball.
Some of today's grumpy old men are irritated by the things that are obviously designed to annoy us, like nouvelle cuisine or road signs in Welsh. And some are irritated by unexpected things like school plays or Lloyd Grossman. But there is one thing that irritates each and every one of them, beyond endurance, driving them to verbal violence and only stopping there because physical violence is not an option.
Welcome to British Airways London Eye.
Champagne flight is called.
Fast-track ticket sales line.
Press 3.
Thank you for calling Arsenal Football Club. For mail order.
A customer reference number or security PIN has not been recognised.
Hello, and thanks for calling Sky Plus.
Number.
To help us answer your call,
please quickly as possible.
First
digit of your security PIN.
Please press the star button on your telephone twice.
Press 2. Please press 1.
Please dial 0 now.
Press 1. Press 3. Press 0. Press 1.
If you're a member with numbers from with an 8-number digit, press 1. If your number is a 6-number digit, press this. If you have been a member for so many years, press that. If you're a gold member, press that.
If your printer is not working because the interface is not aligned properly with the hosing channel, press 1. I don't bloody know why my printer's not working.
25 minutes before you actually get something that says to you, would you like to speak to an operator?
You have to go through all these stages till you get, and now you'll be put through to customer services. Which is all you wanted in the first place.
Is that the marketing people's idea? We'll get a load of people at home blowing steam through their ears because they've had to listen to Rachmaninoff play tinnily between computerised voices asking you questions you don't know the answer to.
But Grumpy Old Men is not so much a television series, it's more a way of life. Weary of sitting and taking it in the guts, our grumpy old men are plotting the fight back.
Phone rings. Can you confirm your surname and postcode, please? I said, no. She said, I need positive identification that you are the person I'm speaking to. I said, it is definitely me. She said, but you have to prove it. I said, OK, I'm 2 stone overweight and I've got a small dick. And she said, pardon? I said, I'm 2 stone overweight and I've got a small dick. They're just proving that it's me. She said, I can't believe you said that. I said, well, I'm positive identifying myself. She said, I'm sorry, Mr. McGrath. Aha! You mentioned my name. I said, I'm sorry, I can have you for sexual harassment. And she put the phone down. I thought, oh, thank God for that.
If you wish to speak to me about my overdraft, press 1. If you wish to speak to me about my New Balance that I wish to open, press 2. If you wish to speak to somebody other than me, press 3. And then when they've done that, you say, OK, I can now put you through to an operator and just do all that for like 25 minutes. I mean, because that's what they do to us.
Thank you. A member of our team will be with you shortly.
The first thing they say if you ring up the train inquiries is, which train are you where are you travelling from? I'm like, no. This is an inquiry line. I ask the questions.
Which station are you travelling from? I said, pardon? Which station are you travelling from? I said, sorry, I understand the question. What station are you travelling from? I said, I'm not travelling from any station. I'm standing by the phone in my bedroom. No, why are you phoning? I said, I want to know if there's a bar at Oxford Station. What time are you travelling? I said, I might not be travelling. I just want to know if there's a bar at Oxford Station.
Welcome to the Odeon Film Line.
I love to speak to a human being. I mean, I love to be able to phone up Camden Odeon and just say, hi, it's me, can I have a seat?
Putney? Wapping? Watford? What? Oh, shit. What number was Putney? Oh, just the bang. Start again.
They didn't say, oh, sorry, that one's sold out, or, you know. They wait until the end and say, your credit card will now clear, and oops, sorry, it's all in fact sold out, do try some others. And you go, what the fuck have I been doing sitting here? You know, because you're like this on the fucking mobiles.
Oh, bollocks. See, mobile phones, I didn't want to get one, and now I've been forced to get one by people, and some of that withheld number. Why can't they tell me who's ringing up? Yes, what do you want? You've had an email. Simon, I'm not interested. I'm on camera at the moment being a grumpy old man and you've interrupted me, all right? Well, I'm sorry, I can't. I'll have to talk to you later.
What makes me fed up about mobile phones? My goodness, it's the director. That's a terrible thing when that happens because you lose so much respect.
I'm so sorry. Sorry about this. I'll be right. I hate phones that go off in the middle of interviews, don't you? Hello?
Somebody answers the phone.
The other day, I took this train journey, and a bloke sat near me. He was making so many phone calls. It was just like being in his office. But you know, I wouldn't have minded, but he had me doing photocopying, making coffee. His wife's away this weekend. I've got to go to Paris with him.
People used to take holidays, and they wouldn't be contacted by the firm, you know, while they were away on holiday. Always on holiday, you know. They won't be hearing from him for 2 weeks. But now you go away on holiday and you're still on the phone. You never really stop, do you? You never stop. That is one curse of the mobile, is that there's no end. There's no holiday.
The minute that I got one, I became fetishistic about it, yeah.
It's funny, though, but, you know, men are very sort of sensitive of the size of their willies, but when it comes to talking small, the smaller your phone, the better.
All I require is that it's the smallest one, really.
But as their partners kindly remind our grumpy old men, it's not the size that matters, it's what you do with it. And what some people do with it is guaranteed to drive them into the coronary unit.
I don't mind people using mobile phones, they're very useful, but I always leave the compartment on the train to speak, because I don't think everybody should listen to my conversation. But you can be in a train, and everyone's like, "Hi, is Elaine there? Is Greg? Yeah? Sorry, I can't hear. Someone's talking on the phone here. I can't hear what you're saying." And there's four people in the compartment, all the same thing. "Has that stuff come through from Tim in accounts yet? What? Hang on, I'm over a tunnel."
So Rory devised a strategy, which we heartily commend to grumpy old men up and down the country. It's a fight back.
It'll be locked up after this. But I used to sing if someone started talking on the mobile phone. You know, say hi, Graham, yeah. And I go, "I'm coming home, I've done my time, and I've got to know what is and isn't mine. If you received a letter telling you I'll soon be free." He said, "Hang on, Greg, there's a bloke singing in the, you know." And he said, "Then you know just what to do if you still want me. I'll call you back."
One tie, yellow. Blame on me if I don't see a yellow river around the old oak tree.
What a great song that is.
What they promote is a meaningless level of anonymous chit-chat with people where you don't actually have to get down and dirty and smell somebody or see their body language. They are actually the very, very, very key representation of the anomie and alienation of our culture. And the idea that it's actually a cash bonanza from mobile phone licensing that the government predicated its entire second-term spending plans on is one of history's most delicious ironies. And when it all comes down, when it all falls down about us, all that will be left in the wreckage of our civilization is a single tiny little black oblong going, "Doo-doo, doo-doo, doo-doo," and there'll be nobody to answer it.
Next week, an average day in the average life of an average grumpy old man. You wake up in the morning, and it's all downhill from there.
And there's now an official Grumpy Old Men handbook, especially written for anyone who has sympathy with self-confessed whingers.
I must get Andy through his transplant, but my prognosis is weeks rather than months.
Yeah, but my biggest fear is that my mum won't know whether my treatment's been successful or not.
One Life on BBC One now.
Politicians used to offer us dreams of a better future. Now they promise to protect us from nightmares.
Those evildoers.
And have stumbled on a way of restoring power and authority to governments. Yet just as their dreams weren't true, neither are the nightmares. In a major new series, we see how our climate of fear was created and why.
who benefits, and how much of it is an illusion. The Power of Nightmares, coming soon to BBC Two.
Threatened by water and disease.
These islands have been sinking from the beginning of time.
Destroyed by fire, plagued by family feuds, and consumed by the quest for power.
The hated led to fighting, blood and death.
Writer-historian Francesco D'Amosto unravels the mysteries of Venice, a city that rose out of the sea to become the greatest piece of art the world has ever seen. Venice begins Saturday at 9:10 on BBC Two.
Now on BBC Two, Gavin Esler with Newsnight.